Hello, welcome to Downtown Variety. I'm your host, Mattie Barber-Bockelman, and this is the 16th edition of this wild show that takes us all over the world with artists telling stories from their homes, from outdoors, and from their communities. We started on March 20th, 2020, and as we were told to stay indoors, and now that we're still indoors, I'm in my home in Brooklyn, New York, but we are going to connect tonight with artists in remote locations and see more spaces in their communities. The work that you're going to see tonight is going to happen in LaMama's Ellen Stewart Theater in the East Village, Amphibian Stages Theater in Fort Worth, Texas, and a studio and a home in Los Angeles, and a beautiful natural landscape in Bremen, Germany. In these spaces, artists are rediscovering and transforming how we create theatrical space. We really get to open up a window to another world, and I'm excited. Now, technically, it's a little complicated and it keeps evolving. You might think that we've done this so many times, it should be easier, but you know, we're experimental theater people, so we kind of just keep making it harder on ourselves. It keeps evolving how we make this show. We're still not fully aware of the limitations here, and the more we get to know them, the further we try to push them to still tell a story, to evoke an emotion. This week, there's been so much figuring out on our feet and in the room together and adjusting and pivoting, and I find it truly hilarious that we're even using those words, on your feet and in the room. But hey, as Abigail Broud once put it, even though we're online, we're still downtown. So let's go. First up, we're going south to Fort Worth, Texas, where we are collaborating with Amphibian Stage and Christopher Michael. Amphibian Stage is a family of artists, patrons, community members, and leaders who passionately use theater to foster empathy, motivate thoughtful conversation, and connect each of us to our own creative imaginations. Performing live from their theater in Fort Worth is Christopher Michael, a poet who has been rocking Texas mics for 20 years. He is the co-founder of Killeen Poetry Slam and a regular host at Austin Poetry Slam. Among his accomplishments, which are many, are 2005 to 2006 Austin Slam Champ, 2008 Killeen Slam Champ, 2010 Arkansas Grand Slam winner, and a three-time national finalist. So, Christopher Michael at Amphibian Stage.
Haiku, 1963, white supremacist bombs church, four little girls, spark. I was born in Birmingham, Alabama in 1911 on 16th Street. By born, I mean they finished my construction. I was erected as an edifice to the Almighty, a place of worship, a rally point for justice fighters, and a war room for the commanders of the cause. I can name drop, but that would be rude. Martin Luther King, Ralph David Abernathy, thousands of people released millions of prayers beneath my roof. I stood witness to hopes, dreams, marriages, baptisms, and homegoings, but of all the dignitaries to grace my pews, the most important, the most beautiful, the most precious were Denise, Addie Mae, Carolyn, Cynthia. They were visiting me for Sunday school or something to the like. There was a lot of turmoil in those days. I could tell because I'm all the comings and goings and whatnot. Some fuss about integration. Even our illustrious governor, George Wallace, had something to say about the issues of the day. Let me see. I think what he said was to stop integration, Alabama needed a few first-class funerals. Shortly after, a white gentleman placed a package under my steps. At the time, I was a little 50 years old. I grew to know what the faces of men meant. Each one told a story or revealed his heart. I knew that was no gift set before me. I could feel the spirit of the Lord shudder with grief. I knew I had to do something because those four little girls were still within me. Girls, you got to get on home now. Maybe if my steeple wasn't such a tower, I could do more than babble. I tried so hard. I yelled with everything I had. Girls, you gotta get from round here. But all they could hear was me moan and creak like I was settling in my foundation. I was no longer like the servant Peter. I could not be their rock, but in that split second of eternity, I contained the blast. I held back the wave of Satan's hellfire like I hold on every prayer whispered in my walls. I used all my strength to stop the embers. I secured the shards. I refused the splinter. I bound every brick. I subdued the mortar. I stood in the gap in the twinkling of an eye. My God needed to call them home. They felt the love of my Lord. They grieved not. But even eternity ends. I could not hold back the blast forever. I realized all I could do was blanket their bodies in what was left of me, swaddle them in my destruction, tuck them in with my dust. I won't name the white supremacist who was convicted of this crime. But Denise McNair, Adam A. Collins, Carol Robinson, and Cynthia Wesley transfigured into a spark that fanned the flames of freedom. And I had the honor. I am so sorry that I could not save you.
Christopher Michael at Amphibian Stage in Fort Worth, Texas. Wow. Man, it's not every day that you get to be reached by a performance with that. Hey, Christopher.
Hootie hoo.
What is going on?
Oh, I'm happy to be here. This is incredible. I mean, I do miss being in front of crowds and them responding directly to emotion, but being in front of a mic again and knowing that somebody somewhere is getting reached with a new story they may not have heard or been aware of, this is incredible. I'm so thankful to be here.
Man, we are so thankful that you are here, because I know that you in your own life, you know, you don't live, you live a little distance from Fort Worth and you've got an important job.
It's no big deal.
Yeah. So you really, I don't know, everybody at Amphibian Stage really is making this show happen, which I'm, it's such a thrill to be really collaborating with another room of people.
Yes. Watching these humans behind stage, making all the tech happen is wonderful. I was really pleased. Yeah. And awed at what they make happen.
Christopher, can you tell us a little bit about this poem and the impetus for it, where it came from with you?
So I remember exactly. I was in the movie theater watching the movie Selma about Martin Luther King's March on Washington. And in the first 5 minutes, they show those four little girls walking down the steps of the church, and then the church explodes. I wasn't ready for that. It caught me off guard, and I spent the rest of the movie in the back writing the poem with the thought how horrible it must have been for this sanctuary to realize that it could not protect the people that that dwells inside of it. And it's supposed to be a sanctuary. And the thought of that church being powerless to save those children is what really triggered me to write the poem. I spent the rest of the movie crying, writing the poem, crying, and this is what came out.
Man, we should let Ava DuVernay know about this. We should send her this clip and let her know that this is one of those connection points. You know, art begets art.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. If anybody who's inspired from something that I say or do, that is just another way of me becoming immortal. I can't live forever, but to know that my art does, or that my art inspired more art, that's incredible.
Hey, you've definitely inspired me tonight. I know there's a couple other people at a safe distance in this here theater. Hey, Kathleen.
Hey there. How are you?
Hey, good. How are you? So would you just introduce yourself to folks?
Yeah, I'm Kathleen Culebro. I'm the artistic director of Amphibian Stage. And it's funny, I'm looking over where I see your image instead of looking at the camera, because I'm new to this. This is so exciting. Thank you. Totally. I have been a fan of La Mama for all of my adult life and been going to shows there. It's just a very exciting moment, and to be able to create work in such a new and exciting way. We thank you so much for including us.
Man, so this is the first time that we've really, you know, connected to another theater, a theater space that isn't La Mama's. And what I love so much about working, especially with small theaters, is like we were going around in the rehearsal introducing ourselves, and there's, you know, Evan is like, I'm the marketing associate and I'll be operating the camera. And Kathleen, you operated QLab for this, right?
Yes. I now am a QLab expert.
Which I love. I love that everybody's just like, you know, evolving. Yeah, let's go. But how's Amphibian Stage been doing in the pandemic? And how have you felt yourself or your community changing?
The way that we've kept our sanity is to really pivot and think about how we can serve our community and use the tools that we have, because we couldn't just stop. And we have the luxury of being a nonprofit, which is not usually a luxury, but our supporters are very generous. And, you know, I heard somebody say the essential workers of theater are the actors and the technicians. And those are the ones in theater who have lost their work. And so we felt a huge responsibility to them, because we as administrators and as creatives with, you know, full-time job hadn't lost that work, but we don't exist without them. And so we started creating innovative ways to keep them a little bit employed. So, you know, if you follow our social media, that's really what we've been producing is community work, work for actors, work for designers. We made a lot of masks and to hire costume designers, and just tried to do those kinds of things, and tried to think creatively. And that's kind of how I learned about Christopher. And when I saw his work, I thought, oh, we need to work with him, and people need to hear this beautiful work. What shall we do together? And this very, very innovative and exciting project presented itself. And I thought, bing. But I love the fact that we're learning new things. I love the fact that we are now changed in how we understand that we can make theater. And I hope this is just the first of many. This is my job application. Let's do this a lot more.
I'm in it. We're all in it. This is just the beginning. I totally agree. And there's no reason that we should be not connected.
Absolutely. There are good things that have come out of this very difficult time. Yeah. And this is one of them, bringing all of us together, knowing that there are people all over the world watching us. That's really exciting.
Yay. Okay. Thank you so much, Kathleen, Christopher, Michael. I can't wait to see what comes out of you next. Clara, Evan, Jeff, everybody at Amphibian Stage who made this such a exciting process. All right. See you later, Texas.
Thank you.
Cool. Amazing. So next we are going to a video work by Nao Bustamante, who is a current CultureHub resident artist in Los Angeles and is an internationally known artist originally from California. Her precarious work encompasses performance art, video installation, visual art, filmmaking, and writing. The New York Times says she has a knack for using her body. So this is a video work reveal by Nao Bustamante.
Thank you.
All right. Next up is Dane Terry. So get your tissues out or some booze. Dane Terry, who is a melter of hearts and also a multimedia story maker, performer, and composer. He has made stories and music for all sorts of rooms, and he's been up to this for quite some time and intends to stay up to it, which we are very happy about. And we're very excited to be working with him exactly right now, exactly this way. So now, live from 66 East 4th Street in the Ellen Stewart Theater, Dane Terry.
Couldn't take my eyes off of him. All day long at the swimming pool, I couldn't stop watching him. Something about him was, I don't know, different. I mean, for instance, the color of his swimming trunks was like light orange, I guess, is the way I would put it then, you know, as a 12-year-old boy. Although now, as an older gay man, I might say tangerine or peach or sunset, but at that point I just said light orange. You know, and it was like maybe a little too light for a boy. And it made me feel a little weird about my own swim trunks, which were light blue, but were they too light? And could I really trust my mom to buy my swim trunks from now on? And also, some of the other kids had said that they thought that maybe his name was Kevin or Brian or something, and that he was going to start school with us in a couple of weeks when school started. But I didn't want to think about school because it was still summer, and tonight was the best night of summer. Because tonight was the annual night swim, when the pool stayed open an extra 2 hours, you know, from 9 to 11, which only happened once a summer. And like, it's already swimming at night, which are like feels like you're being bad, so that's great. But then also the adults usually get out of the pool from 9 to 11. No adult wants to swim after dark. They'd rather just stay on the grass and get drunk with their friends. Also, they turn on these giant overhead lights right at 9 o'clock to signal the start of the night swim, so that the whole pool becomes this sort of blue diamond kid fantasy world where we can be anything we want. For 2 hours, it's just our land in the middle of the pool. But right now it's 8:45 and I see orange shorts or Kevin or whatever his name is get out of the pool on the opposite side, and I lose him in this sort of dim grassy area by the fence. And right then the lifeguard blows their whistle and everybody gets out of the pool. It all clears out. Now the kids go back to their towels, right? And the moms are trying to do mom things, like getting them to, you know, eat food. You know, like, honey, just a piece of cheese or something, a piece of candy. You know, you've got 2 more hours of swimming. You don't want to cramp up. I went back to my towel too. And my mom tried the same mom stuff, you know, was a little calmer. She said, honey, why don't you finish your walking taco that you didn't finish earlier? Now, in case you don't know, a walking taco is a bag of Fritos with chili or hot dog sauce and liquid cheese in it. It's pretty good when it's hot, but this was cold. I ate it anyway because I was kind of hungry, but the whole time I was keeping my eye on the other side of the pool where I had seen orange shorts get out, you know? And so I tried to bring it up casually, and I was just like, Mom? I think I'm gonna swim on the other side of the pool, if it's okay with you, for the night swim. Now, my mom had been, shall we say, not swimming for a couple hours at this point, so she was pretty laid back about it. She just said, okay, baby, just stay where I can see ya. So I went down to the edge of the pool. And I walked the line of kids that had all gone back down to the edge of the water to wait. And we still had, you know, probably a few minutes before the lights came on and the night swim started. But they were there just sort of covered in slashes of cherry juice and potato chip crumbs, just breathing heavy, looking at the water. And they looked like a band of Vikings getting ready to raid a village. And I got to the far corner of the pool and I turned and I tried to look for where Orange Shorts was, and I couldn't see him at all. There was so many people over there, you know? And there were people turning on radios and people yelling like, hey, Helen, I haven't seen you since the barbecue. And then right then, a flash of light, and a whistle, and just then the whole pool erupted into this frothy mess of kids just everybody running into the water. Except for one kid. Just 10 feet from me. Like once everybody else had cleared out, he was really right there. Orange shorts. And he stopped once he saw me looking at him. And I got a little closer. And a little closer. And then finally I was so close that if I didn't say something, it'd be a little awkward. So I swallowed and I said, "Hi, my name's Dane." Now, at this point, I could see two little versions of the pool reflected in his eyes. And I knew that pool was full of kids all pretending to be whatever they wanted, you know, mermaids, pirates, their fantasy, you know. So I should not have been surprised when this boy looked at me and he said, "My name's Voltan, Destroyer of Stars." My eyes got wide. And I said, "Well, know this, Voltan. This is my water world, and I am its defender." And his eyes narrowed, and he said, "Yes, I know. I've come here to meet you in battle." The way that you run when you're not supposed to run. Awkward corners of a big dream did bulge in my denim heart long before I knew your name. Voltan, destroyer of stars, come at last to my water world. Your evil plan, your laser beam, it's no match at all. It's no match at all from my own dark mind. Now let us not go all this long night and only talk of empire. They must have had tender nails where you're from. And our mothers and our fathers, they're drunk on the grass with their radios and their dry clothes. And no one is watching now, and we're all alone. Light or sound. In me, I have the water all around. So we're both not afraid. At least I'm not afraid. Are you? smell of chlorine, but the taste of the sea. For an hour now, they've been looking, calling our name. But one frozen moment are we, photon destroyer of stars and me, my gun to his hair, his gun to my hair.
Dane Terry, man, reeling. So Dane Terry is an incredible artist, and if you want to hear that again, he's on Bandcamp. So if you Google search Dane Terry Bandcamp, you can find a live version of him doing Live at the Largo, and it could be a really good nightcap for you tonight to, you know, lay back, put that song in, and just be transported. It feels so good to almost be in a venue, and I'm sure it feels good for Dane Terry too. So now, to recover, let me share a special announcement. CultureHub is launching a store. Yes, you heard it right. We have a curated collection of one-of-a-kind items, art objects, apparel, prints, and published works for sale. The store's offerings are physical and handmade counterparts to the digital and ephemeral work that we tend to make. Each item has a unique origin story, whether as a prop used in a past production or a limited edition wearable from a resident artist. The goal is really to just connect you to our global community of artists, technologists, and makers. This idea has been brewing for a long time, but what really propelled us is that on Downtown Variety for the past few months, I've been collaborating with one of my best friends to make these clothes and these earrings. And so we decided to commission her to sell some of her magical creations. And this is the first piece that she's made. These are limited edition, designed specially for CultureHub and LaMama, paying homage to the studios and stages at 47 Great Jones Street and 74 East 4th Street, sorely missed staples in many artists' and audiences' lives right now. And of course, you know, they're 4 and 7, and you can wear them either way. So if you were at a rehearsal at 47 Great Jones and you needed to go see a show at 74 in the future times, there will be future times where this happens, I promise. You can just switch your earrings and you'll be perfectly dressed. There are also two styles of these and plenty other items, including a book, the new CultureHub book, which documents our first decade of experimentation, a shirt by MX Oops. You'll see a lot more by going to culturehub.org/store. Do I sound like that television show where they sell things yet? I hope so. I hope I'm getting there. This was the whole vision. Okay, you'll go there. But first, let's go to Germany. That would be more fun. It's a total pleasure for me to introduce the next installment of work by Aaron Samuel Davis, who is a human who dances, currently creating content based in Germany. His work and research explores themes such as human behavior, storytelling, history, rewritten or reimagined, and the relationship between interdisciplinary arts. This is a very special individual. So now, Aaron Samuel Davis.
Can you bitch fucking Isn't it crazy? All world stumbled. Existence crumbled. To be alone, but to be not lonely. To be hard falling, but hardly hitting ground. Did we once accord that unconditional love is dreams of dreamers, and dreamers be running without legs, be seeing without eyes, be shouting without voice, still be heard, still be heard. An eternal echo ringing back within. Isn't it crazy? Nah, voice shall be eyes, shall be legs. It's all here. As soon as breath reveals what we've yet to understand.
Aaron Samuel Davis, yeah, special person. We're about to have Aaron Samuel Davis join us live from his Airbnb in Berlin, Germany. Oh, hey, Aaron.
Hello.
Oh my gosh. How's the Airbnb?
It's cozy. It's a bit, it's 2:40 a.m.
Oh, right. Yeah, we keep you up late here on Downtown Variety. Sorry about that. So, Aaron,
I love it.
I'm so happy to have you and have your liveness and even feel your liveness, even though that that piece that we just saw was something that you had edited and you had created over, you know, many days of shooting. So that's exciting to me. But I'm wondering, can you tell us a little bit about this, the story of this piece and like the impetus of, oh no, I've said that twice now, but yeah, the root of where this started from.
Yes, of course. I think impetus also is a great word. and this is coming, this is coming from three different places. One was this idea of dance as a form of prayer. I grew up in church, 116th Street, Salvation and Deliverance was my church in Harlem. And this was always kind of how I experienced dance as a form of celebration. And then the next would be after watching The Rite of Spring by two different choreographers. It's a piece that's like a very well celebrated in dance history, but also quite controversial. And one was Melissa Fenley's State of Darkness that was revived this year at the Joyce through Joyce Stream. And the other would be being here in Germany, watching Tanztheater Wuppertal, Pina Bausch's version that has stayed with me since many years now, but also since studying here in Essen, here in Germany. These are kind of the impetus of how I started this research.
And you were talking about the sort of the combination of two narratives, bringing this American narrative up against this this Rite of Spring story. Do you want to tell me a little bit more about that?
Exactly. I could expand on that by saying one image that stayed with me quite hauntingly was this idea of someone walking through the earth and then having their footprints being swept away by someone like following them. And this is kind of how I experienced history in the States, how I understand the brutality of slavery as a Black person growing up in the States, and just how awful it is to have taken people from where they're from. And this stays really with me in this narrative of the Rite of Spring. I'm really asking questions about what is this idea of sacrificing oneself? What does the sacrifice look like? I'm also asking questions about do we have to do a Rite of Spring version that is a slave narrative in 2020? And as we're learning, it's still not over. A lot of these stories or injustices are still happening today. And as I look at this narrative, I'm also questioning, is there space for intersectionality? Do people have sympathy for a sacrificial, let's say it's always usually the trope is the virgin who's sacrificing in this narrative, but would people still have sympathy if the sacrifice was, let's say, trans, a trans woman, a trans Black woman? And so I'm really asking these questions dramaturgically, but also exploring physicality and different movement vocabularies that may help to draw out or make this story or this research a bit more compelling, or something that I recognize, or something that I feel like is part of my history or my communities.
When you're saying the dance as prayer, I can't help but think about the moment where you sort of do that opening up movement and this bird just flies right across, which is, when I saw that, I was just like, no. Oh. I mean, it's just transcendent.
Divine timing.
Yeah, divine timing. But man, and the way you use the frame and the way, you know, the way that you are really choreographing with the camera, you know, it's not like, I'm wondering how that's going to influence this as you keep making it. Even if it goes to be seen in front of large audiences, what will, I mean, this is purely speculative, but how do you think developing this work in front of a camera for this, you know, this frame will change how the piece is made at large, like over the next few years? Hopefully it's like goes to some audiences and gets seen and stuff, you know?
Yeah. I think what you're asking is definitely a question about how we're making work now in this time. And I also appreciate that you said it will happen, that we will be back in the theaters. I think we need that hope. And one way in which I like to choreograph or to create work or content is by using the camera as a tool to either record improvisations and then look back and edit or re-edit those and try to learn them again. So it's always integrated into the work. What's interesting now is that we have to communicate something more clearly what film or other mediums have been doing already. We're putting things on to camera work that are supposed to be fleeting, you know, one-time things or moments. Yeah. And now I'm really taking this as a task to be able to, if I can feel something and it transmits to someone through the camera, then I'm hoping that I learn a little bit more about myself or more about the work, and then I'm able to incorporate that feedback. And so when it does come back to a time when we're in the live space sharing work with each other, that this research then is also felt, because I feel like the distance then hopefully will be less of a factor there.
Aaron, you're such a magical person and a magical mover. You're such a stunning mover. You know, I'm thinking about you as a creator, as a choreographer, but just have to say, man, you can really move with your body and really communicate.
I really appreciate that. And I'm also thankful for the opportunity to keep sharing work with you guys. And I look forward to continuing to see what's happening in this evening.
Yay. And I look forward to continuing to see what's happening in your brain and body and everything.
Thank you.
All right. Aaron Samuel Davis, who is joining us from Germany, which is spectacular. Thank you, Aaron.
Thank you, Mattie.
Okay, folks. Our next artist is coming at us live from Los Angeles. Christopher Rivas is an award-winning storyteller, twice winner of the Moth, essayist, actor, Rothschild Social Impact Fellow, New York Times filmmaker, speaker, and creator of The Real James Bond Was Dominican. So we are so excited to start this journey with you, audience, and with Christopher Rivas. So without further ado, Christopher Rivas.
Imagine two lovers, a cabin and a fire. Very simple, very pure. Lovers plus fire equals good. The lovers love and the fire burns. And the fire begins to dwindle as fires do. And so the lovers, they throw on some more firewood. And then the fire consumes and the lovers consume. And the fire begins to dwindle as fires do, and the cold from outside is now seeping in, and so the lovers, they throw on some more firewood. And then the fire consumes that, and the lovers consume each other, and it's warm again. And then the fire begins to dwindle as fires do, and the firewood begins to dwindle, and the process, it just repeats itself over and over until the lovers have thrown on the very last bits of firewood. There is no more firewood. As the fire dwindles once again, consuming whatever you give it, nothing to sustain it, our lovers are faced with a choice. Leave the cabin or stay. And they're filled with anxiety. I mean, what if it's not the same when we come back? How do we know we'll come back? What if there's no more wood? But this right here is so perfect. When we leave, it won't be this. It's different. Has it really come to this? You know, our lovers are sold on a dream of what could be and would be, and they become so attached to this dream, they decide not to leave. Right? They start burning down what's in the cabin, tearing it down piece by piece. They begin with the picture frames and then the furniture, and first it's the legs of chairs, then the backs of chairs. Then they just toss the remainder of everything in. The fire eats it all. A little while later, it's the tables, the cabinets, the dressers. Now even the furnitures are doing it. But our lovers are still there and loving, and this moment they're hanging on to, it's still a moment. Finally, there's no more furniture. Nothing left to burn except the cabin itself. It's depressing, really. And we destroy everything just to hang on to a fire that will go out, must go out. We should have gone outside. We would have seen. It was nice outside. It didn't have to come to this.
That's what you were thinking about while you were peeing?
Well, yeah. I mean, I have these like pseudo epiphanies while I pee, these release, post-release, aha moments, this being one of them.
Okay. And what does this story mean to you?
Oh, well, I think I'm the people in the cabin, and I live my life trapped in moments or moments, just afraid to leave them behind.
Wow. That's actually very appropriate for you. Well done.
Thank you.
Tell me, why can't you walk away and trust that there is life outside the cabin? Assuming I'm getting the metaphor right?
That's why I'm here, Doc. You know, I'm not sure if I get some sort of pain of pleasure or pleasure of pain. Can I play a song for you?
For me just to hear or for a reason?
Both, can I?
Sure.
This song came on recently, and my director says to me, Chris, you are very sentimental. Sentimental, it's defined as tender. I looked it up. Yes, I am tender. And one of my best friends is in the car with us, and she says, yeah, have you met him? He dated a girl in Serbia. She didn't speak English. They just smiled at each other. Also true. But my director backs me up, and he says, yeah, that's not sentimental. That's sexy. And Natalie says, no. It started pure. He wanted to marry her, didn't you, Chris? You had a whole story about learning each other's languages or something like that. It always starts pure, she said. It always starts pure.
And?
Well, she introduced me to this song, and I would play it on repeat for weeks. I mean, maybe even months, trapped in the cabin, you know? Am I supposed to stop playing it just because it makes me think of her?
Well, how does thinking of her make you feel?
It's a good song, regardless. It's a good song.
Okay. Regardless, how does hearing it make you feel?
Doc, this is one of many songs, right? I'm not sure I'd have music left or a playlist or anything that didn't make me think of something.
Chris, help me help you. What will it actually take for you to not look back anymore?
Doc, can I confess something to you? Okay, I'm going to take your silence as a yes. I have this Gmail extension app thing. It notifies me when people read my emails. I'm not proud of it. I mean, it can come in handy for work things, but mainly it's just sneaky. I get an email whenever someone's opened an email I sent them. I get an email when they click a link. I see when they open an attachment. I see it every time, and once it's set, there is no way to turn it off. I get an email every time she opens the last email I sent her. Every time. That summer, I wrote you the last email I would ever write you. A letter. It was one of those like file cabinet letters of things said and not said, done and not done. A letter that I hoped would bring me clarity, would say thank you and why and how all at the same time. You opened this email. Maybe you read it, maybe not. You never responded, and that was that. And then you opened it again a couple days later. Again, you didn't respond. And then you opened it a month later. Then you opened it again. And 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 then you opened it again. In total, you've opened that email 27 times. Maybe you read it. Maybe you just opened it. Maybe each time you read a little bit further. I don't know if you read the whole thing. I don't know if you draft an email. I don't know anything other than that you opened it. You opened my letter of things said and not said, done and not done. And each time I expect it to be your last time. And each time I get another notification. And so, Doc, you ask me why I can't let go. Why I'm burning down the entire cabin. Why I am afraid to go outside and try again. It's because we aren't speaking. We are serious cold turkey. And yet I know. Like, I actually know she's thinking about me. Possibly suffering the same suffering. Good session. Same time next week.
Hey, okay. Christopher Rivas, everybody. Okay, and next we're going to see the second video work by Nao Bustamante. And I just want to let you know that she is developing work this year with Culture Hub in Los Angeles called The Wooden People, which is a VR mini series that has a performance art core with a telenovela vibe. Each episode culminates in a live happening or ritual. This melodramatic soap follows archetypal characters from the Mayan origin myth, presented as a subculture group set in the backdrop of a contemporary Los Angeles. So this piece of video art has potentially not a lot to do with that project, but I wanted to let you know that that's what she's working on here with us at Culture Hub. So next is Cross Country Road Trip with Nao Bustamante. Okay, folks, finally our last performance of the night, Shauna Davis. This is such a pleasure to welcome Shauna back for the third time. So this is the third installment by Shauna Davis. She was with us in July, in August, and then she started her residency at La MaMa as a resident artist this year, and she's developing all sorts of work. She also is in Prom on Netflix that came out tonight. So she's a effing superstar. She's amazing. She is in a serious and playful relationship with movement. And we're about to see her move in her studio in Los Angeles. So, folks, Shauna Davis. Shauna Davis. Man, these artists are really working it. It's such a damn pleasure to see it all come together. The work is really happening. And there's nothing like this. There's nothing like Downtown Variety, if I can really dare to say that. And there never will be ever again. Man, so everyone has made something truly unique tonight, born of these circumstances. And I just can't wait to hug everyone that we've met through the cameras. Couple things. This shirt made by Verna Estes, I just had to say it in case you didn't know. I want to shout out CultureHub's technical team that's making all of this happen. Jean Garcia, who's on the camera in the Ellen Stewart Theater. Sangmin Chae, who's the creative technologist, wizarding, yes, it all up. DeAndra Anthony, who is the lead technician and directing all the madness. And we had Marielle join us this week. Man, it's a pleasure. So tonight, another special thing to send us out. We have Dane Terry playing us out one final piece. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll be back next month. I'm Mattie Barber-Bockelman. Happy Hanukkah.